Hey, what's up guys? My name is Acherno and welcome back to my OpenGL series. Man, I'm so excited to finally get around to doing this series. So over the last two episodes, which are kind of the first two episodes of the series, we really just were setting things up and we were setting up GLFW and glue and basically everything we needed to be able to draw graphics in an OpenGL window. And now that's finally set up so we can start writing some OpenGL code. Now I know I keep saying this, but I just want to say it one more time. We're not making a game engine. We're just learning OpenGL here, which is why I'm not going to bother like doing this properly, so to speak. I'm just interested in showing you guys what OpenGL code you actually need to write to make things happen. How you choose to abstract that and kind of move it into like classes and all of that, that's your business. And certainly when the game engine series comes out, which is gonna be very soon, wink, we're gonna cover that anyway. So just keep that in mind. Don't expect that this is how you should write a game engine or how you should make a game using OpenGL. This is just what OpenGL code you need to write to make graphics happen and how it works. So the thing with modern OpenGL is that it's very programmable, much more than the legacy kind of OpenGL. It's pretty extensive, it's fairly powerful, there's a lot you can do with it, and as a result, there is quite a lot of setup you actually need to do before you can see a triangle on the screen. Now, what we did in the last few episodes, in fact, and I think the first episode where we set up GLFW, is we just used legacy OpenGL. We just used GL begin and GL end to draw a triangle on the screen, because that is like five lines of code and you're done, here's a triangle. It's easy to just do and it requires no setup. However, to draw a triangle using modern OpenGL, a few things need to happen. Primarily, we need to be able to create a vertex buffer, and we need to also be able to create a shader. Now, I am planning to make a video soon in the future that's just gonna cover kind of how graphics pipelines work and specifically how the OpenGL graphics pipeline works. So we're not gonna get into that too much, but let's talk about what we need now to draw a triangle in modern OpenGL, because every piece of graphics that we can possibly render on our computer begins with a triangle. So I mentioned two things that we really need here, right? We need a vertex buffer and we need something called a shader. Let's talk about what that even is, just quickly. So a vertex buffer is basically just get rid of the word vertex, because it's just get rid of the word vertex from that. It's just a buffer. It's a memory buffer. It's an array of bytes of memory. That's what it is. It's just a buffer. And what I mean by that is it's literally like a blob of memory in which we can kind of push bytes into there, right? And the idea is, of course, because it's tied with OpenGL, it's not just a buffer of memory, like as if I just created a char array or something in C++, and you know, that's a buffer of memory, right? The difference is that this is a buffer of memory in OpenGL, which means it's actually in our GPU, in our VRAM, our video RAM. So the basic concept here is I want to define a bunch of data which represents my triangle. I want to put it into my GPU's VRAM, and then I want to issue something called a draw call, which is basically a draw command, which says, hey, you know that bunch of that blob of data you've got there in your VRAM? Read from it and draw it on the screen. And furthermore, we actually need to tell our GPU how to read and interpret that data and how to actually put it onto our screen. Because once we kind of do everything from the CPU side, everything we write in C++ is just done on the CPU, right? Once we've written all of that stuff, we also need to somehow tell the graphics card, once we issue that draw call, which does come from the CPU, once we issue that draw call, we need to actually tell the GPU, okay, once you interpret, once you get access to that data on the GPU side, I want you to lay it out like that. I want you to draw me and rasterize me a triangle on the screen. So we need to tell the GPU what to do. So we need to program the GPU, and that's what a shader is. A shader is just a program that runs on the GPU. It's a bunch of code that we can write which runs on the GPU, and in a very specific way and in a very powerful way, which we can explore in the future. But that's basically the gist of it. Don't overthink it too much. We just basically have a bunch of memory that we can specify, right? A bunch of data that I can specify, tell the GPU, hey, here's this data, and then from the GPU side say, okay, now read this data and interpret it in as like a bunch of positions on your screen maybe and join them up into a triangle. That's kind of how this whole thing works. And that is the foundation, the basics of all of this kind of OpenGL rendering code. It's just what I've just described there. Have some data, then draw me something. Now, it's really important to note that OpenGL specifically operates as a state machine. What that means is that you don't necessarily treat it like an object or anything like that. What you do instead is you set a series of states. And then when you say something like, hey, draw me a triangle, that's very contextual. What I mean by that is, instead of me just saying, hey, draw me a triangle, and then passing in everything that OpenGL needs to draw the triangle, it actually knows already what it needs to draw the triangle because that's part of the state. So to put it another way, you basically say, I want you to select this buffer. I want you to select this shader. And then draw me a triangle, right? And based on which buffer and which shader you've selected, that's what's going to determine what triangle gets drawn and where and all of that stuff. That's how OpenGL works. It's a state machine. That can be annoying. In fact, it probably is annoying, but that's just how it operates. Learning that and just knowing that is just very important for OpenGL in general, so keep that in mind. And so with all of that in mind, I do want to keep this series a little bit more practical, so let's just write some code to create this vertex buffer and see what we can do with that. Okay, so what we have here is what we kind of wrote in the first episode, which was this basic triangle that we drew by specifying three vertices, right? And we did this by using legacy OpenGL, which was very easy to do. What we now want to do to basically draw this according to modern OpenGL is create a vertex buffer which just contains, well, this data. There it is, that's our data. We just want to actually put that into a buffer, send it to OpenGL's VRAM, and then later issue a draw call saying, hey, draw my buffer, please. So to do that, we're definitely going to want to go outside of our while loop. This is just our games loop, right? We don't want to be doing this every single frame. We can just define a buffer to begin with, and then we can actually fill it with data. And then inside the game's render loop, we can just say, hey, draw the data that already exists. If for some reason we would require to actually change that data frame to frame or something like that, we can do that as well by just updating the buffer, and that's totally fine. But for now, since of course we're not changing this data, you can see that our triangle is not morphing into something else or anything. It's just a bunch of static vertices. We can kind of do that outside of this game loop. So over here, I'm going to define my vertex buffer. And the way that this works is pretty simple. You just type in GL gen buffers, right? Then you specify how many buffers you would like. So OpenGL can generate you a bunch at once. We just want one buffer, so I'm going to type in one. And then we need to give it a pointer to an unsigned int. You can kind of see here that this function returns void. So instead of returning the ID of what we generated, we instead provide it with an actual integer and it writes into that integer's memory. That's why this takes in a pointer. So what I can do is just type in unsigned int, I'll just call it buffer, and then pass in the memory address of this unsigned int. Now, what this is the ID of the generated buffer. Remember, OpenGL works as a state machine, which means that everything you generate, again, this is contextual, so basically what I mean by that is textures will have kind of their own stream, buffers will have their own stream, but everything you generate in OpenGL gets assigned a unique identifier. It's just an integer, 0, 1, 2. 0 is commonly kind of an invalid state, but not always, so again, something you need to learn, which we'll cover in the future. But basically, you get a number back, like 1, 2, 3, whatever, and that's an ID for your actual object, whether that be a vertex buffer, a vertex array, a texture, a shader, anything, right? You get a number, an integer back, which represents that specific shader. And then you basically just use that number whenever you want to use that object, right? So if I want to bind or select my buffer, because I'm just about to render my triangle and I need to specify which buffer to use to render my triangle, I just pass in that integer. It's like, hey, can you select buffer number 2, please? That's how OpenGL works. So that's what this is. This is generating a buffer and giving us back an ID. So now we have an ID. Once we've created an actual buffer, we now need to select that buffer. And selecting in OpenGL is called binding. So I just type in GL bind buffer. Now this is the target. So I've generated a buffer, but how do I want to use it? Like, what is the purpose of all this? For us, this is just a buffer of memory. So we're gonna use GL array buffer, which basically just says, this is just an array. And then you can notice that we do pass in the ID of the buffer. So this is the buffer that we're binding. And of course, it's the one that we've just generated. Pretty simple so far. Hope you guys are keeping along with this. And so the next logical step is obviously to actually, well, put data into that buffer. You may have noticed also that I haven't actually specified how large this buffer is or anything like that. I've just created a buffer and I've bound it, meaning that I'm just about to work on it. So the next step is going to be to actually specify the data. Now there's two ways you can do this. You don't really have to provide it with data straight away. You just have to specify, when you create a buffer, you usually specify how large you want it to actually be. So for example, I don't know, 200 bytes or something like that. And then you have the option of straight away giving it data, or you can just give it nothing and then later update it with data. That's totally fine. Since we obviously know the triangle that we're drawing right now, we might as well provide it with data straight away. So I'm going to type in GL buffer data, and then again we specify the target, which is GL array buffer. The size, meaning how big we want this buffer to actually be, or how big our data is. So in this case, let's kind of calculate this. We have all of these vertices here. Let's actually declare them as something else. Right now they're just kind of numbers here. Let's make a float array which contains all of these, right? So I'm going to write float positions equals, and then we'll kind of make an array out of it. So first of all, I'll define how many I want. You can kind of just define arrays like this in C++, but I like to be a bit more specific. So we know that we have 6 vertices by looking at this, 6 positions. So I'll just put in 6 here. And then I'm actually going to specify them. So literally, if I scroll down here and copy this, I'm holding Alt Shift and then clicking from the kind of the top to the bottom here. Control C, Control V, and there we go. We have our vertex positions. Now I like to kind of align them as well. We have to add commas here as well. But I like to align these, so I'll just hit space here to make sure they're nicely aligned. And then we have a basic buffer. You could also call this a buffer, right? Because it's an array of contiguous memory in which we have 6 floats. So over here, we need to specify the size. Now, because this array was created on the stack, I could just say size of positions. I'm really not a fan of doing that though. So what I'm gonna do instead is just say 6, because we know that we have 6 floats times, well, the size of a float. So it's important to note that this size is in bytes. Now you might be wondering, how on earth do I know that it's in bytes? And the answer to that is, well, of course, experience, but you also should be reading the documentation. So this is a good chance for me to show you guys what I think is probably the best documentation website for OpenGL. And that is docs.gl. So I'll put a link to this in the description below. Basically, this is a huge kind of documentation resource here for OpenGL. It has a lot of OpenGL versions, including kind of the embedded systems version. So the mobile versions of OpenGL, as well as GL 2, 3, and 4. So what we're gonna do up here is just type in the name of our function, which is glBufferData. I'm gonna click on GL4 because that's the version that we're using. And then over here, you can see that there are two overloads. Well, there's one called named buffer data and one called buffer data. Well, obviously this is the one we're interested in. You can see there's our size variable or our size parameter that we're passing in. If we scroll down, we can look at the size and you can see that it says specifies the size in bytes of the buffer object's new data store, okay? And then you can see also for data, which is our next parameter, specifies a pointer to the data that will be copied into the data store for initialization, or null if no data is to be copied. So you can see just by reading the documentation how easy it is to see how you can use this. Like for example, we now know that we can just pass in null if we don't want to provide it with any data to begin with. The usage is also something that's important. So it specifies the expected usage pattern. So basically the idea with this, and I think if we scroll down here, you can see that there is the usage is a hint to the GL implementation as to how a buffer's object data store will be accessed. So with that in mind, we can specify stream, static, or dynamic in here, which is basically stream means that it's going to be modified once and used at most a few times. Static means that the data store contents will be modified once and used many times, right? So that's actually the one we're leaning towards, and I'll tell you why in a minute. And dynamic, the data store contents will be modified repeatedly and used many times. So the reason static's important, stream is not something that we use too often, to be honest. Static and dynamic are kind of the ones that we care about. Static just means that it's going to be modified once and used many times. What that means is you can see that we're going to create this buffer once and we're not going to modify the buffer every frame, but we are going to draw it every frame. So that's what it means by used many times. It's going to be drawn like every frame, in this case, our triangle. Whereas dynamic is something where the data store contents will be modified repeatedly and used many times. So if we were also modifying this triangle, modifying these vertices every frame and drawing it every frame, we would be using dynamic. Now these are just hints, meaning that if I declare this as static, and then I draw it and then I update the buffer every frame, it's still gonna work. It's probably just gonna be a lot slower. So just keep that in mind. This isn't like a set in stone kind of thing. It's just a hint. In fact, it says here in the notes that usage is a hint to the GL implementation, okay? So with that in mind, we now know how to fill this out, hopefully. So the data that we're gonna provide it with is just gonna be a pointer to this positions thing. Now this already is an array. So of course we can just write positions. And finally, GL enum usage. So that's the usage that we just talked about. We want to use static. So GL underscore static underscore draw. Now, I didn't talk too much about the draw thing, but of course we will be drawing the actual triangle. So draw is the one that we care about. Okay, cool. So there we go. We've actually specified a bunch of positions for OpenGL, and that's really all we need to do. Now, normally we would also want to create something called an index buffer, but we're going to have another video about that in the future because I don't want to make this video too long. But basically what we can do now with this data, theoretically, is draw it. Now we don't have a shader to actually specify how the data is being drawn. And we're actually gonna talk about that in the next episode. But What we will do today is just see if we can draw it anyway. And we'll just see what the code required to draw this as if we did have a shader. So back here, this is all the code we need to actually give OpenGL the data. However, whilst we've given OpenGL the data, we haven't actually told it what the data is. Remember, OpenGL is literally, if you kind of look at this, receiving a void pointer of data. It's receiving a bunch of bytes. Now, how on earth is OpenGL supposed to know how to interpret those bytes, right? They're just a bunch of bytes. We haven't specified that, hey, we've given you three vertices, they're floats, and also we've given you two vertex positions kind of per vertex, or two floats represent one position, which is a vertex, right? We haven't said any of that. What if we have texture coordinates or normals or other things? And it doesn't make any sense. OpenGL can't just magically be like, oh, I see what you've done. You want me to draw you've kind of specified two component or 2D kind of coordinates, and you just want me to draw a triangle with them. No, not how it works. We need to actually tell OpenGL how our data is laid out. And that is something that we definitely need to do, because remember, from the shader side, we want to be able to read this data in an appropriate way. For example, this kind of vertex position that we have up here, I'd love to just be able to read that as a two component vector, right? As a vec2, or maybe even a vec4, so that I can multiply it with a matrix in my shader or something like that. We need to be able to tell OpenGL how our data is laid out. And we can do that by using a function called GL vertex attribute pointer. Okay, now that is, again, something that is very closely tied with shaders, so we're not going to talk about that today, but just keep that in mind. We're not really ready to draw yet. But if we were, let's take a look at that. So I'm going to scroll down over here, and instead of having this junk here where we ran triangles using immediate mode, I'm actually going to issue a draw call for this buffer. And the way that we do that is very simple. There's two main ways of doing that. There's GL draw arrays, which is something that you do if you do not have an index buffer, and we don't have an index buffer, so we'll look at that. You can see that we need to specify the mode that we're drawing in. What this means is, what kind of primitive are you trying to draw? In this case, we're trying to draw a triangle, so we just type in GL triangles. The first is basically just an offset. Again, you know, documentation, right? I know all this, but for your sake, let's go ahead and take a look at what GL draw arrays actually does and how it works. So first specifies the starting index in the enabled arrays. So in other words, if we for some reason wanted to start from the second vertex, we would type in 1 here, right? Because we start at 0. We do want to start from the beginning of our kind of list of vertices, so I'm just going to write 0. And then finally the count, which is the number of indices to be rendered. Now, indices kind of means vertices in this case. So we have 1, 2, 3 of these. So you just type in 3. And theoretically, if we hit F5 to run our program, you would see a triangle. However, since we've written like 30% of the code needed to render a triangle, you're seeing a black screen. But this is basically the idea. The other draw call that we have is something called GL draw elements, which is something that we use with an index buffer. So in this case, we kind of specify the same thing, GL triangles, then the count, so 3, the type, which is actually the type of the index data. So if we're using like an unsigned int or an unsigned short, we would put that in there. And then finally a pointer to the indices, which we almost never use. So that's usually just null. But again, we'll look at that when we look at what index buffers actually are. So that being said, that's the draw call, right? This is the line of code that actually draws our triangle. Now you may notice here that it doesn't specify, well, anything. I mean, it says that it's a triangle, it says that we're starting at 0 and we're drawing 3. How does it know to draw this one? And that comes back to me saying that OpenGL is a state machine. When we were writing this block of code, and we wrote this code right over here, GL bind buffer, that is what is going to be drawn, the one that is currently bound. If before we did this, we bound no buffer, which you do by binding 0, then this would not draw our triangle because we've selected something else. I like to compare this to using a program such as Photoshop when you select things in Photoshop. If I select a layer and then draw something on that layer using the paintbrush, it's going to affect that layer. However, if I have nothing selected or I have the wrong thing selected, obviously it's not going to be affecting the layer that I want to draw on. OpenGL is the same. You need to select everything or bind everything before you actually do stuff with it, because that's how it works. It's very contextual. It's a state machine. Anyway, I hope you guys enjoyed this video. It's a bit of an introduction towards vertex buffers. We've still got a lot to cover, including kind of all the vertex attribute stuff, shaders, and index buffer kind of objects. That's what we've kind of gathered from this video, that we need to do a lot more work. But that is the basics. Hope you guys enjoyed this video. If you did, you can hit that like button. Leave any comments you may have in the comment section below. If you want to talk about this stuff with a lot more people, you can join my Discord by going to thechannel.com/discord and joining it there. There's a bunch of people there and we talk about this stuff all day long. So it's a good time. Also, if you want to help support this series and you want to see more episodes, as well as get access to all of the source code that I write in these videos, episode by episode, then you can support this series on Patreon by going to patreon.com/thecherno. You'll get some pretty cool rewards. You may have noticed the on-screen credits at the beginning of the video. It's what you get by being a cool supporter, and there's a lot more kind of stuff, as well as getting these videos early, which I think is pretty cool. Anyway, hope you guys enjoyed this video, and I will see you next time. Goodbye.